Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the action potential, and in part 3, we're going to see how it gets propagated in neurons. So we're going to use this schematic neuron. It has dendrites, a cell body, the axon, and one representative synaptic terminal. The initial segment is the first portion of the axon. This is usually where the action potentials start because this area has the highest density of voltage-gated sodium channels, and we already saw how important those are. Just the generation of an action potential isn't enough. It has to reach the terminal end of the neuron. How it reaches there is by propagation. I'm going to turn this axon into a rectangle so that I can put in the potentials. At rest, the membrane potential is negative. When the action potential starts, this becomes our active site. There's depolarization. The membrane potential is becoming more positive. This area forms a current sink. The propagation happens with these local current circuits. Positive charge from the membrane ahead, carried by those sodium ions, flows into the active zone. And from there, positive charge flows towards the adjacent zone, which is inactive. The flow is because of the charge imbalance. And this current flow, it'll be depolarizing the next portion of the membrane. If that portion of the membrane reaches threshold, the voltage-gated sodium channels will open and there will be another action potential. Now this is the active zone. And the same thing is going to happen again and again, the circular current flow. But let's take a step back. We saw how the currents move forward. But what's stopping the current from depolarizing the membrane behind it? That can't happen, because once the action potential starts in this area, this portion is refractory to a second stimulus. That's the refractory period. The refractory period in a neuron, it could be absolute or relative. Most of the duration is in the absolute refractory period, when a second stimulus cannot make another action potential happen, doesn't matter how strong it is. That is mainly because of these sodium channels that get inactivated. They have to come back to that closed state before another action potential can happen. During the later part of the action potential, there is a relative refractory period. That's when a second stimulus could elicit an action potential, but it has to be a stronger stimulus. That's because this part mostly overlaps with when potassium conductance is higher, which is making the membrane more negative. So a stronger depolarizing stimulus would be needed to bring it up to threshold. Since the action potential has started in this part, it's already in its refractory period, and that's why it can't go backwards. The same circular currents keep moving forward, and at each point, a new action potential is getting generated. Since at each point, the membrane has to be brought up to threshold, and then the action potential has to happen, it's to the same extent every time the membrane depolarizes to threshold. It's not like a graded potential, which would decay with distance. Once that action potential reaches the synaptic terminal, it's going to stimulate the release of a neurotransmitter. This conduction is orthodromic, where it's going towards the synaptic terminal. If a stimulus were to be applied at the center of the axon, the propagation would happen in either direction. Orthodromic is towards the terminal, and antidromic is backwards. But the synapse is a one-way street, so the one going backwards can't cross the first synapse it encounters. So usually it's orthodromic conduction, and we're looking at an unmyelinated neuron. Myelination changes the way action potentials get conducted. The process of myelination is done by Schwann cells in the periphery and oligodendrocytes in the central nervous system. Each Schwann cell myelinates a short portion of the axon, so in between there will be small gaps where the axon is exposed and unmyelinated. These are called the nodes of Ranvier. Myelin is an electrical insulator. The voltage-gated sodium channels, they are highest at the initial segment, that's before the myelin sheath. That's why action potentials usually start here. In myelinated nerves, they also accumulate at the nodes of Ranvier. Myelin increases the membrane resistance and lowers the membrane capacitance. So the current flows through the extracellular fluid outside the myelin sheath and through the axoplasm, along the paths of least resistance. Again, there are circular currents, but here the areas that are myelinated, they don't generate action potentials. Myelin increases the membrane resistance, so instead current flows through the axoplasm, and at the next node, there's generation of another action potential. So the action potentials happen only at the nodes and not in between. So it's like the action potentials are jumping from one node to the next. This is called saltatory conduction, and that's how it happens in myelinated nerves, versus continuous conduction that happens in unmyelinated nerves. This saltatory conduction increases the conduction velocity and reduces the energy spent for conducting impulses. Another factor that increases conduction velocity is diameter. Larger nerves that are myelinated have a higher conduction velocity. And that is how action potentials get propagated in myelinated and unmyelinated nerves. If this video helped you, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.